Hey, lab coat agents. Thanks for joining us again. We're trying to bombard you with education that you can use for the market that you're in. And today we've got one of our admins here, Vanessa Noble. She's also a really good friend of mine. Love her. And I love that she's always giving back to the community. That's why we love her here as well in Lab Code. So Vanessa, thank you for being on. Can you just give a short bio about what you do, where you're located, and why you're a pro at this?
Yeah, so I am a realtor in Anchorage, Alaska. I am stationed at Joint Base Elmendorf Richardson. Donna says she can't see me. That's okay. If you can hear me, then you'll hear it.
Can you see her now? Let's see if they tell us if they can see you now. Yeah.
Yes.
All right. Good.
Yes.
They can see you. Good.
Yeah. All right. Good. So Anchorage, Alaska is where I sell real estate and am also stationed with the Air National Guard here. I have been here since 2006, originally from Los Angeles, and have been in real estate since 2014. There is quite a bit of a situation that happens when you're helping, being in Alaska. So you are geographically isolated from the rest of the country, right? And when you're serving the military community that are inbound, you also have to overcome some challenges with inbound military that are also all over the world. So when you have to think outside the box and be resourceful, just the nature of our business, you develop some skills that kind of help you with bridging those gaps, whether because we're isolated or they're far away. And a lot of military spouses and realtors often end up with what's called like reverse PCS, where they have a business in one area and then they have to move, the military moves them, and now they have to be the realtor from afar. So like their business stays in one area, but they move, right? Because the military sends them. So just in having that be kind of organic to this military relocation and military real estate niche, there's definitely some processes that we have established for a long time now that are inherent to helping people virtually and meeting with people virtually. And it's kind of funny because if you think about it, it's not different. It's no different than this. You're on a webinar right now. You're listening to me speak. I'm talking to Tristan, but we know that and we're familiar with that in our business and in masterminding, but maybe not so much in, you know, in client interface. And most of, probably one of the coolest places I have met with a client is over Skype in Turkey. He was deployed in Turkey and he's like in a tent and like talking to him about real estate investing. there's so many things that you can overcome through technology. So it's really an amazing time to be in real estate.
I love it. Well, that makes you a pro at this. I didn't realize that because you were isolated in Alaska, even though there are people there. All right. So I didn't realize that you were so isolated in a sense because people can't go there, take a look at property and come back. You have to kind of virtually show them and sell them on something. So I really didn't think about that until you just brought it up. That's so cool. So look, let's start with.
Occasionally. I've only had two people fly in to do tours ever I've been selling real estate now. This is 6 years, about 320 people.
No way.
Only two.
That's insane. I love that. All right. So let's get right into it. When people reach out to you, they reach out to you by email, they reach out to you through social, they reach out to you through Google. How do they reach out to you? Is it referral based? Tell me.
So we run a niche here through Facebook groups, through our military community. I also do web leads. I am very referral based. Whoops. That was my military unit right now. I am very referral based. I'm referral heavy, agent to agent, and client referral. So when I started, it was in Facebook communities and building out my military niche through Facebook communities.
Mm-hmm. I love that. All right. And so when people reach out to you, they're reaching out to you from all over the place.
All over the world.
when you talk to them over the phone, I'm assuming they already
know.
Oh, you don't? Tell me this process. I want to know it.
Yeah. So a lot of times, you know, thankfully to, you know, Facebook, I mean, most of people that I meet are all over the world on Facebook. So we will, you know, engage in a lot of what they are looking for, or they'll inquire about me as a realtor through Facebook. And then we will set up a Skype. And there's two kind of ways that I help them feel comfortable to get on a Skype. Number one, I will offer to show them the geographic map. So this would apply to other people in other, you know, states. If you had someone that was coming from out of the area, the best thing that they love. And so I'm an intel analyst in the military, right? And so what I love to do, what we do as an intel analyst, is we'll like go geographically into the neighborhoods, and I'll explain like, hey, so this area and that area and this area, and here's the school, and this is where there's traffic, and this is where you'll work, and this is this building. And so like that is kind of natural to me as an intel analyst. So that's one thing that people really enjoy, because they're not from the area. And so, you know, if you have somebody that's not local, telling them that you're going to go over a community map and talk to them about neighborhoods and schools. And they really are intrigued by that, because they love to get on Google Map and like look at the map with you and stuff. So that's one thing. And then number two is going over their real estate goals. So then that's another thing that we, if they're very, you know, education minded, they want to go over their whole real estate strategy. So then we'll jump on a Zoom after that.
All right. So can you explain some of the technology that you're using to connect with people? Because right now, the way that we've done it is just through FaceTime in the past, or through Google Hangouts. Those are the free ones if you have a phone, for either or. How have you been doing it? I heard you're using Skype. Is that what people are normally using when they're doing this?
It depends on their connection. So I'll do Skype. I'll do you know, Zoom if it's appropriate. I'll do FaceTime, WhatsApp, depending on what part of the country and what service, like internet service they have. Although oftentimes, so face-to-face interface, yes, those are the tools that I use. But when I actually do showings virtually, I like to do video and not FaceTime. Because if you do FaceTime, they lose it. You know, they can tell you what they want to see, but they can't keep that video unless you do Zoom. That's a
good point. So you send them the recording after? Is that how it normally works?
Mm-hmm, correct. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so, Vanessa, do you ever have to do a presentation like to a buyer, like about who you are, background?
So when I set the appointment and we have this like virtual appointment, I'll send them either the Calendly link or the Google invite. You know, if they had to think about a time or schedule a time, then I'll send them the Calendly link. If I set a time with them, then I'll send them the Google invite. When I send them the Google invite, I send them an email. The email has the PDF and a video. So there's a video intro that I send that is more personal, so they get to see my face for the first time, because usually we've been chatting or maybe emailing. I'll send them that video that says, hey, I'm Vanessa. I'm looking forward to meeting with you. You know, we'll go over your goals. What I'll say about virtual selling, this is the disclaimer to everybody first. There is a huge responsibility, because when someone lands in Alaska on a plane into this like crazy new place that they have no concept of what it is, I literally give them keys to the house. Sometimes they've already signed for the property. And it's like, you think that like giving people a bow on a car is exciting, but like they literally trust you with keys in hand in a building they've never seen. And sometimes I've never seen the building. So,
on going. I'm sorry. I have a lot of questions. Keep going. I'm sorry.
Yeah. So the weight of responsibility, it's weighty, right? So there's a couple of things that I'll caveat this with, okay? I ran a construction company before I was in real estate, okay? So I have an eye for seeing things that maybe might not be natural to the average realtor, like discriminating what kind of flooring or what windows or what countertops, right? So when I'm looking at stuff, I'm able to distinguish finishes well. And so you know, you have to be experienced a little bit in order to do this with some conviction, because you never want to sell anybody anything, especially because you'll get a bad reputation fast if you sell people the wrong piece of real estate.
Well, that's what I'm scared of with people not being able to see it, right? I've only done a handful of transactions sight unseen through video, not like you, right?
Right.
And that's always important for me.
So, and there is a list of things that I'm like super mindful of looking at. And my inspector partners are also very aware that the buyer is sight unseen. We do sight unseen a lot in Alaska. My last listing that just went live, I had 3 sight unseen people that wrote offers on that property. So, so the inspectors are also very, sorry about that. Inspectors are also very mindful that they are engaged in a sight unseen, purchase. So they're paying more attention to cosmetic flaws. I also have to set the expectations with the buyers that all houses have cosmetic flaws. So we want to expect to see everything. I also set the precedence with the buyer that I'm going to be very negative about the property. Any property that we see, I'm going to scrutinize it through a very judgmental lens, because if they are still interested in the home, they're going to take all the flaws with it. And so if I've been in the house, I know if the house smells bad. If so, I sent somebody else to the house, I will ask that question. Do you smell water? Is there a pet odor? Those kind of things that you can't really tangibly touch. And then also included in the list of things that I'm really mindful of is, you know, any water issues around the bathroom that can visibly be seen, but an inspector is going to catch that. Perception of room, we'll get room dimensions so that they have, because sometimes when you have an empty room, the room feels bigger than it actually is. Then you put a sofa in it and you can't really fit in places. And, another thing that I look at in like a living room is livability. So when I'm selling a sight unseen and I'm looking at the layout, another thing that I scan for is how are they going to live in this property? Being military and going from house to house to house in a training pipeline, when the military has pushed me into 5 houses in literally 18 months, what you recognize is the layout of your house really, you know, the home that you create can really weigh on your psyche and on your like mental health, and whether you're frustrated or depressed because there's, you know, you just don't live function well in your home. So you kind of get a taste of a lot of that having so many homes when you're military and being relocated all over the place. So when I'm looking at a house for a buyer, I'm also like, okay, is there a place for a TV? Does this layout work for them? How are they, you know, do they need 2 living spaces? So your brain does have to be a little more like analytical when you're like, number one, assessing the needs of the client, and number two, analyzing the property. So the skill of like, and not only that, not only like, is this a good home to buy, and can, you know, is this a good home to buy, and would they, number one, you ask yourself, would you buy it? that's number one. Would you buy it? Number two, my buyer's consult isn't 3 bedrooms, 2 baths. Like, what do you want to buy? It's what do you want to build when you buy this piece of real estate? What's your end goal when you're looking? Because the reality that, yeah, you know, you can sell a pretty house, but you're helping them make a huge investment, and the weight of that. And yeah.
Vanessa, I'm feeling like with the process that you have, you're connecting with these people almost deeper than we normally connect, which is—
I connect with everybody like that.
that's good. I'm glad you're going through this process, because the last time I did anything that was virtual where they didn't see the home until they bought it, like a week after, I know exactly what you're saying. Which you go into the property, and now you're taking a look at it a lot differently. You're like, okay, where do I put this? And I had to go down to the floor and see how high one small difference in the tile was because this guy's handicapped. And I'm going like, I'm measuring it. And I'm like, okay, guys, it's like 2 inches, 1.5 inches. And I'm going through the whole property frequently.
Yeah.
So it's interesting that you mentioned that. So it's just
so like one time.
All right, so
time, Vanessa, I had somebody that refused.
Vanessa, you froze there for a second, but you're good now.
Are we there? Can you hear me?
Yeah. I can hear you.
Oh, okay. So she had an heirloom china. Can you hear me? Yeah.
Good. We're
yes,
good.
Yes.
Yeah. The video is a little bit off, but your audio is right on.
Okay, cool. So she had an heirloom china cabinet that was 9 feet wide that she had to fit in the dining room. So I had to go measure every wall. And so that was, I didn't like measure every house. So you don't, it's not that weighty, because as I'm sifting through properties, number one, I'm looking for, is this a good financial investment for the client, for the stage of life that they're in and the investment goals that they have? That's number one. Okay. So I talk to them about their life picture, their financial goals. Like, why are they making this investment? So we create that whole picture for them. Then when I'm looking at like the list of inventory and I'm considering analytically the needs of their family and the way their family, like this same one with the china cabinet, she was going to have her mom move in with her who couldn't go up and downstairs. Okay. And so I needed to find like an extra bedroom with a bathroom that didn't have. So when I'm going through this, and Alaska has a lot of like 3-level floor plans, I'm like eliminating a lot just out of like, I know that doesn't work. That doesn't work. That doesn't work. So then when I get it down to like 3 that are potentials, then I find the one that feels good to her. Right. And is in the right fit from an investment standpoint. And then I go measure a wall. So I'm not going measuring every freaking kitchen in the state of Alaska.
Right. Makes sense. Right? Makes sense.
Then I go measure questions a wall. Yeah.
2 questions for you. One from Amanda. Amanda McCabe. 3 questions. Amanda McCabe's, on average, how long are your videos?
Oh, so it depends on the platform you send it. If you're sending it over Facebook, you have to keep them under 3 minutes because that's the amount of video that will transfer.
Okay.
So Facebook video is really good for people that are out of area. If you're sending it on WhatsApp, you can send a longer video. So as you're doing the tour, you have to get a little good on video. So practice in your house. I like a portrait orientation instead of landscape. Yep. Because it doesn't get the ceiling and it doesn't get the floor to ceiling view.
And the bathrooms.
Yeah. And so, you know, when you're scanning, and by the way, like realtors, it doesn't have to be you. So mega agents, it doesn't have to be you, right? I mean, in the state of Alaska, you have to be licensed to do a tour. So if you have a licensed showing agent, it can work this way, because, you know, when you're selling large volume, like you're like, are you serious? I need to do all these videos. It may not be you, but you have to train someone to do it well. And so, use the tripod if you can. So to stabilize, you know, you don't want it to, be shaky. You don't want it to be fast or you're going to make people vomit. And so you have to really, be very slow and steady in your videos, but not too slow or they get bored. So yeah. I've had people give me feedback of like, yeah.
And these are recordings. They're not like lives that you're doing with them, right?
I prefer recording unless it's a group Zoom that I can record.
Yeah.
But even then, when you record a Zoom, the quality is low. So when they tell me they want to get on FaceTime, I tell them I'm going to send you a video so that way you can keep it forever and you can scrutinize the video over and over and over again.
Yes. Good point. Ladina's asking why not Zoom. That's why in some cases, once you send the Zoom over, or even if it's being recorded, it's not as high quality as if you just record it and then send it out. You miss a lot of the details. We've done it in the past.
So, yeah.
And also Zoom, if you don't have it, you have to pay for it too. So that's another
to record it.
Yeah. So the other question, Ryan Carney has a question. What are some of the notices of caution, if any, that you propose to buyers, or advice for selling properties unseen to agents? What's some of the advice you give?
Yeah. So as my fiduciary duty, I don't tell the listing agent that my client has not seen the property. I protect their, unless they directly, I will not lie, so they can ask me. Sometimes they see you on video that you're by yourself, but I don't offer that information, because if, especially a lot of listing agents have not dealt with sight unseen, so they're very nervous and they'll try to make your earnest money hard from the get-go. So I'm very quiet about that. When I have a sight unseen buyer, I hold those cards really close. And so there is some people that do high volume sight unseen. We do have disclosure that you can offer that they can't back out on certain conditions. However, I do have a guarantee that if they do hate their property, I will sell it for free. So I guarantee that the real estate sale on the other end, like within 90 days, it's a guarantee that I personally offer.
Mary Jane's asking along those questions, along that line, is there any disclosure that buyers sign in case they have a buyer's remorse?
So some people, I've only seen one team in our market that do that. I don't make my clients sign buyer's remorse disclosures because I feel like you need to do a good job. You know, I don't mind putting that at the end of the contract, you know, but you don't want to load people on the front end because you're really invested in them trusting you. And you have to do a good job. You have to call in your inspectors. You have to just make everybody's like level of responsibility higher. And so inspectors have done a good job. You know, and sometimes it's crazy because sometimes having a re-inspection done by a different inspector is actually very valuable because they'll see stuff the other inspector didn't see. So one thing, for example, if you have someone that's very nervous about a home, having two different inspectors is good because they'll naturally see different things, just they're human beings, you know?
Yeah.
Especially if you didn't, if, for example, if I was going to pay for an extra inspection and I'm a mega agent that I don't have time to go to the property, you know, and it's a $300,000 to $500,000 home, I would pay $400 to $500 for somebody to go inspect it on my behalf, you know? So you just have to do what makes sense for you in your business. That's worth the cost of sale and also the peace of mind that for you and for your client.
Awesome. All right. There's a whole bunch of questions, Vanessa.
That's so okay.
Bear with me.
We can go through the process, you know?
Yeah. There's one specific that keeps on coming up. Besides, if at any point in the future in the group, can you share your video or one video that you do kind of like a walkthrough?
Sure.
The other one that is being repeated is, can you please explain how you would approach a seller with putting their house on the market and virtually marketing it and all that with the coronavirus situation? Because I think with what you've done in the past is very similar to what I think you can do now. How would you approach this in this environment?
Well, the great thing is that the virus has also created a desire for the seller not to be too like close to anyone, right? Yeah. Before talking a seller in, it might not be the best like selling script, but now you're like, because we have the coronavirus, I have a process where I don't need to go to your house. They're like, I love you. So number one, your value as a realtor is literally your economic and analytic skill set to give them guidance and advice. If you have sold 50 to 100 homes in your career, then you should know your market, you should know your neighborhoods, you should know your homes. And if you're a new agent, then do a ton of research. If you're a new agent, before you try like giving sellers a bunch of advice, go do a bunch of showings by yourself without clients. Go look at real estate in your market, because you have to. The biggest thing for my sellers that helps me give them a ton of advice without seeing their property is I know layouts. I know neighborhoods. I could look at a map and I can gauge a square footage. And all I need to see is the intangibles. Like, is their neighborhood crappy? Does their neighbor have, you know, is it bright yellow or do they have a broken down RV? You know, things that are going to really diminish the quality or the resale value of their immediate house. That's what I call intangibles. Do they have a beautiful view that no one else has? You know, so I look for intangibles outside of my natural CMA, right? My comparative market analysis. So when I go with the seller and we're talking just like this, me and you online, I'm talking to them, what are their goals? I'm doing, so this is very natural to me because of my military intelligence job, same thing that I do in Intel. I'm looking at a picture, right? And so I'm going through their comps. I'm sending them their emails. I love to send them the app, the old closed sale link, so they could click through pictures of another property that's like theirs, not just the report. So I send them the link that when they're going to organically compare their property to price, I send them the link of all those properties so that they can click through the condition of other pieces of real estate themselves. So when I come to justify a price, I've done a thorough job of giving them information. I don't need to see the property. What I could do is they can video for me, and that's valuable to video. I like to video on Zoom and on FaceTime because I've done this when I've been out of state and the seller has been here. Mm-hmm. So, and the seller was, you know, someone that was referred to me and they really wanted to work with me. So they would go through their home and I'm asking them to take me to different parts of their house, you know? And so, and then they take pictures because I do this at every listing consultation anyway. I go in and I take pictures of all their mess because then when we go through the decluttering, I like for people to see pictures of their own mess because then they're like, oh man, my house looks really bad.
That's funny.
Yeah, so those virtual tools are things that I already use, you know? So we just put that on a virtual conversation. We'll go on Zoom and I ask them to take me outside, look at their neighborhood. When I do virtual buyer's consults, I literally will take video of the neighborhood. So I have a mount in my car, like a GoPro mount, mm-hmm. and I will video about a radius of about a quarter mile, just different routes that they can take into the neighborhood. So I actually get street view for them, not just the Google Street View that was recorded 4 or 5 years ago, but no kidding, like live view of it. And I look for things like chain link fences or bars in the window or things that maybe they're not inherently looking at. So that way I can give them indications of safety or, you know, just property value.
All right. So question for you. There's a whole bunch, but I'm just going to pick the ones that I think are relevant right now. Only because there are so many. How do you pre-qualify someone out of the country as opposed to somebody locally? I think we can really apply this one to our current situation too.
Yeah. So a couple of things with pre-qualifications. Obviously right now as people go through underwriting, it is going to become increasingly difficult to know what 90 days out looks like or 40 days out looks like when it comes to employment. Yeah. So from people that don't have federal jobs, it's going to be hard to really, as a realtor, you're taking a risk, you get someone in contract and they may not be able to close the underwriting file. You might have to extend and who knows the truth about our current situation. For military clients that we have, even though they are federal employees, if they're coming like with PCS orders, they're not going to come. There's a freeze on that. So now we can only work with local, like veteran buyers. But my pre-qualification, like skills comes from, you know, I always pre-screen before I send to a lender. You want to talk about their employment. You want to have very vulnerable conversation about their money. Because if they can't talk to you honestly about their money, then you're not building trust. Like, yeah. And I talk to them about the way that I lead with asking them is when I'm doing the basic buyer consultation is I talk about earnest money. And then if you're dealing with civilian, I talk about down payment. So I give them an example. I say, if you're buying a $500,000 home, your earnest money is going to be $5,000 and your down payment is going to be blah, blah, blah. If you're using this type of product. So do you have this money in your bank account? And you just look at them. And veterans, I can say I can negotiate down earnest money for veterans because they have zero down. So their earnest money can be soft, but I have to lead with that when I write an offer. So how are you comfortable with writing a $10,000 check or a $5,000 check? And they will like tell you like yes or no or maybe. And you need to get people comfortable with talking to you about their money. Because if not, we're going to start writing offers on people that either are going to have to like buy groceries with their down payment, you know, or their reserves because or pay their mortgage payment or keep their extra investment properties afloat. And now you're in contract and they can't close the loan because they don't have their down payment money. You know, maybe they had a job, but now they don't have their reserves. So you have to, as an agent, your skill level has to go up with being able to partner with the loan officers, because while loan officers are bombarded with like running refis and their head is spinning all over the place, we are the ones that are daily talking to our clients. So your skill level has to go up with being able to justify and help your, number one, I never like to take a buyer to the closing table and have them not close on the property. Guess who's going to be scrambling to find them an Airbnb, or they're going to be sleeping on my couch? This girl. So like, like I'm going to be like, okay, storage in my driveway. What can I, how can I help you? So it's your level of responsibility as a realtor, as you guide people through the insights to this, you have to increase your knowledge set and being able to guide them.
All right. So great answers. How do you market a home online where you want to market it to other people? People are saying, well, you use 3D tours, you use virtual staging, you do that video that you do. Where do you place these videos so that people can see enough of them to reach out to you without having to see it in person?
So the video is going to be huge, which is great because all real estate has gone to video. And then we have the tools called the Matterport that we use. One of my photographers has the Matterport scanner, which is crazy because there are virtual goggles that were on the market, but it was also very expensive to have these goggles and mail them to people. It was logistically challenging. So the best thing that I have found is the Matterport tool. If you find a photographer in the market that owns one of those cameras, they're about $3,000. That's the best way to send a photographer to go do a scan of the property. It takes about 2 to 4 hours, depending on the size. And I have a listing right now and that I have a Matterport, and I'm actually filming one today. So I can post that in the group, a Matterport scan, if people haven't seen it. That is crazy, like amazing, because it does give you like the virtual ability to like zoom in on a countertop, right? Like you can look closely at the finishes and you can see the floor, and that's really a powerful, but be good. So get like improving your video skills and your transparent honesty about how the house feels and how the house looks is going to be key. You have to be like no filter. You can't be a salesperson. People are trusting you. So you have to be like, yeah, this is no, you know? Yeah. And so you have to be able to be a naysayer. And I tell that to my buyers, I'm going to talk you out of the property. This is our relationship. And if you really still want to buy it, then I know this is the house for you, because I'm going to say, tell you, no, your kid's not going to fit in this room. No, this doesn't work based on our conversation. No, this bathroom is going to be too complicated. And when they tell me, yeah, but we can overcome that, and then that's when I just let them make their decision. But it's based on all of my critique.
All right. Here's a good question by Stephanie. Stephanie's asking, in the time of the virus here, some sellers don't want people to come into their home. One idea I've had is to offer to be the only person who will come and tour. Sounds like it would be best to leave out the fact that I will be recording a video unless asked, or we could ask the seller to send us video clips. What's your approach on this?
So, you know, I love that, because I have a seller right now that's you know, she resisted a showing today. That's very good for us as the listing agents to go in and to be the ones to show. But what you can do, so I just thought of this right now. So when I sell multifamily property, okay, I sell multifamily property all the time where my buyer only sees one unit and they still make an offer contingent on viewing the rest of the units. And I ask the listing agent if they've seen the unit, so they can like give me insight on condition, as long as it's consistent to the one that I'm seeing, because I don't want to have to renegotiate thousands of dollars because one unit is crappy. But what you can do is, if you do what you're saying and you do a video that's personal for them, or a FaceTime personal for them, then you can say, write an offer and you can do a showing. The offer can be contingent on seeing the property.
Perfect.
So that's someone that is resistant to showing the property, but the person is actually physically there. So, you know, you can still offer that service.
Cool. I have a question from Raquel. Can you share actual dialogue to reassure sellers in this present environment that their house can be sold despite what's happening?
Reassuring sellers is, you know, we want for sellers, you want to still put inventory on the market, because the only way to establish consumer demand or where the economy is going is to make sure that supply is presented so that buyers can determine market value. The only way we'll be able to see a rise or fall in real estate values is if we are having low ball offers written or people not being, you know what I mean? So sellers still want to present their inventory as normal, and, you know, to their own like motivation of, are they moving? And like, really, like, if they're moving, were they relocating? Are they moving locally? So kind of going deeper with, number one, if you're going to sell somebody's house and they're going to move and then they can't leave the state, like, think about where you're leading them, right? So so you want to be able to give appropriate guidance that's specific to each seller's needs. But I am encouraging sellers, put your home on the market, because until we see what buyers are able to do, we're walking in the unknown, all of us. And so you don't want to try to sell them this certainty in this uncertainty, because there really isn't certainty. None of us know the answer. But what we do know is we can move forward and present our, you know, just like we would see in an increasing or declining market. We're gonna put our property out according to comps. We're gonna set the precedence of value, and then buyers are going to determine that. And we're gonna see absorption rates shift, you know, whether homes are stay longer on market. I mean, Alaska has a geographic land, you know, not landlocked, but we're locked in. So like, Alaska has to like live here. Where are we gonna go? Canada? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So we have to kind of stay, but you guys, you're like lower 48, you guys can drive to different, more economic communities. So everybody's local market is going to be a little bit different. Yeah.
You just called us lower 48. I never heard of that. That's so cool. Yeah. I didn't even think of that. We're the lower 48.
You're the lower 48. Just like, what do Hawaiians call us? Call you guys the mainland?
I don't know. That's right. That's interesting. I'm in California, so I never heard that before.
I'm born and raised California, 24 years, California girl.
That's so funny.
Yeah, so those are my thoughts. You have to tell sellers, you know, we need to press as we would in this time. And by the way, agents, I do have my sellers buy their own photos right now. Because you can even offer to pay half, because you're going to go into this. They're going to go into this. There's going to be a lot of unknowns whether these listings are going to pend, you know, I mean, that's just the reality of it.
So how are you answering the question from the sellers? How will you be selling my house? That's the question from the seller. If you don't want people coming in, how are you answering that? I know you kind of answered it before.
I had this conversation last night. If they don't want people coming in, but especially when they're like, market my home. And I said, you realize that when I market your property, I'm going to get more people that want to come into it. Right. And she just laughed. And then, you know, so asking the right question than what you tell them. I think the idea of being the one person to do the virtual tour is really valuable for your seller. So that is really good. Making offers contingent on physically viewing the property when your buyer is local to the market and sellers are resistant to letting people in. So you know if they have an offer in hand, you've reviewed their pre-qualification letter, you've talked to their lender, you already agreed on some financial terms, but the offer is contingent on them viewing the property based on your video or based on the Matterport scan. So that's another great way to get over this hurdle.
I love it. All right, let's see what else we got here. Just some comments. According to my experience, virtual tours helped me to sell three houses, just to encourage the agents on this chat to invest in that. Thanks for that. I appreciate that. And we've got What are the other pre-screen questions before sending to a lender?
Oh, so I talk to them about their job history. I talk to them about their career plans, because if they tell me they're leaving their job, I'm like, okay, problem. So their career history, their career plans. So I get to know what they do for a living. You know, when I talk to them about money, I get to have an idea of their reserve, their capital, how much fluid cash flow they have. So I really have a thorough conversation about how much money do they own. Do they own other pieces of real estate? Because other pieces of real estate are going to help me calculate in my head that they need to have reserves to buy their next pieces of real estate. So then I ask, like, what, you know, what their mortgage payment is on that, because I know they need 6 mortgage payments to requalify for another property in reserves on top of their down payment. So yeah. I'm asking them a lot of pre-qualifying questions, and this is me just getting to know them, because guess what, maybe they want to sell that property. Now I have an outbound seller listing that I need to refer to, right, in another state. So sometimes you're talking to them, they're like, yeah, I have 5 properties that I need to sell. And that's a red flag for me, because I know that unless they are cash flowing properties, they're not going to be able to qualify for a new owner occupied loan, because in most loan products, they're only able to use about 75% of rents towards that property. So depending on the performance of each piece of real estate that they have, if they're not filing taxes correctly, it's going to kill your underwriting. So, you know, their DTI, it's going to get impacted on their debt to income ratio. So, you know, it's hard for me sometimes to, all of this knowledge in my head is just through experience and learning lending at a very granular level, but that's what has helped me be like strong as a realtor. And I didn't do lending before. I just, I think it's the nature of me being an intelligence analyst. I'm somebody that has to understand all the things before I feel like I can confidently give guidance.
All right. Good, good, good. Yeah. People are on the fence, and a lot of them are fearful, right? Mm-hmm. How are you calming them and helping them believe that you can sell the home right now? What are you doing? Are you doing anything along those lines? Because you just had to talk to somebody yesterday, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, number one, I think creating a solidarity with your client that you're here to help them get to their goals, because you want to build trust on the fact that you're going to be completely honest with them. I don't want a seller that doesn't trust me or my guidance. Why do I want a listing that's not going to sell? So if I don't believe I can sell a property, I'm going to say that. I'm not going to try to convince them of anything, because I'd never like to set expectations that I can't deliver on. So the best thing that you can do is have a very like honest conversation to say, like, there's a lot of unknowns in our economy, a lot of unknowns in the buyer demand. Mm-hmm. So the truth is that you can't guarantee anything. I would love to be able to guarantee you all the things and promise you the world, but I can do the best that I can do to give you the most market analysis to give you the most insight on your property based on what I've even seen in the last market crash. So yeah. You can take statistical trends based on when we saw the last market crash, blah, blah, blah. Right. So, you can use that dialogue, and it's going to be hyper local to your market. Alaska didn't get hit in the last market crash. I bought a home in 2009 and I got $6,000 off my asking price.
Wow.
So we didn't have a market crash. Alaska is very isolated, but that's going to be a different conversation. But guess what? So it's the best market. When the market is low, it's when you buy. Who has the most capital? So right now your business might look like a lot of buyers. Find the people with the piles of money, because they're the ones that are going to be able to capitalize on buying low, right? And if that's where our market is heading, that's the pipeline you want to build. And I'm coaching to like real estate business, like protection, but that's not for sellers. You know, for sellers right now, like my sellers, I'm like, if you have a deal, let's close it fast, because I don't know if that person's going to have a job in 2 weeks.
Yeah. So you brought up 2 good points here, and we're dealing with a situation as well. So we have buyers and then we have sellers. Our sellers are concerned. They're coming to us and saying, well, can we sell our home in this market? And I'm telling them, look, we don't know, but we're going to do our best. And these are the things that we're going to do. And if you do need to sell your home, and they do, right? We're finding the right people that need to transact. These people need to sell their home. So they're
motivated,
have no option, right? And so we're doing the right steps. We're just making sure that we're communicating with them. We're letting them know where the market is, how everything is happening, so that they know we're at least trying and doing our best in the current situation. That's with our sellers, right? And we're showing them how we're going on virtually, what we're doing online, all of that great stuff.
All the tools you have to support them.
Mm-hmm. You got it. Now with the buyers, it's going to take you more calls to reach those that are motivated. That's just it. A lot of people are still freaking out and they don't know what's going to happen, but people are still buying. People are still motivated to buy. You have to just find them.
Investors. Find the investors.
Yeah, investors definitely, because they definitely want a deal. And some people are relocating and they need to move, right? They have no option. Even though everything was put in pause, people are still looking to move. I just spoke to a CEO yesterday and he says, look, no matter what, my lease is up in 2 months and I've got to move no matter what. So interest rates are low, he said, and I'm going to buy something. So it's just a matter of,
instead of paying rent, like if you're renting, find the renters, because if they're paying someone else's mortgage and they have a stable job, then they're going to be more motivated to invest, right?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Andrew Weir has a question. Do you find that buyers are more likely to purchase something sight unseen who are in a particular price point, or does it not seem to matter?
It doesn't matter. So people that are lower price points sometimes are a little less, they're a little more nervous because they don't have a lot of resources. So they're more scared with making a big commitment. So people in higher price points that have a little bit more comfort in their financial position tend to be a lot more, you know, willing, but they are also a lot more picky. So you have to, there isn't a particular price point, but you have to know the demographic that you're serving when you're doing sight unseen, so that if you're dealing with a physician that's buying sight unseen, and I deal with a lot of military doctors, you're really picking apart a lot of the cosmetic defects and making sure you're communicating them. So, because you don't ever want someone to see like a gouge in a cabinet and be like, why didn't you tell me about this? Because you'll be buying them a new cabinet face. You know, so you just have to know who you're dealing with.
Yeah, that's it. And you hit it right on. That's exactly it, because we've dealt with all price points, millions and millions, and they are actually easier to work with on sight unseen. And the lower price, we get a lot more picky as to like, only because they're not sure. They've never done this before, right? And
they're learning.
Yeah, so that's the only difference. The last few that we did sight unseen were over 3 million. So it was like easy. We closed in 25 days. They had no issue. Great question.
Yeah, and you know what I'll say though is that it doesn't matter what price point you're at. Everyone wants a good deal. Everyone wants a good investment. Everyone. So whether you're low demographic, high demographic. So when I do my buyer's consult, and whatever their life stage is, and whatever their financial place, I always get them motivated and excited about taking that first step in their life to start their financial investment portfolio and really growing their family's, like, you know, net worth and their value. So I have those conversations. So when I'm looking for a deal, I'm scrutinizing a deal online. There's no way I'm going to 20 different properties just for the sake of like nilly dilly looking. Like, we are looking for the deal that I would buy. And if I'm willing to go buy it, then it's a deal that I'm willing to go look at for a client.
That's a really good point, right? Then you're putting yourself into that position. Chelsea has a question. When you do buyer consults, do you do them through Zoom or Skype? And do you get a buyer agency agreement signed?
So I do them through Zoom more than Skype. Skype to me kind of falls apart. I also do them through Facebook video. I like Facebook video as well. But I do like Zoom the most, just because it feels more, you send them a link and all that stuff. But if they don't have Zoom, then I do whatever is easiest for the buyer. I, in Alaska, we don't have dual agency or dual, like, not dual agency, buyer agreements. Only one person has to cancel. What's the word I'm looking for? You know, like, you know, in some states, the buyer and the realtor both have to release each other.
Uh-huh. Oh, we're in Alaska. Only one?
Only one. So the buyer can fire you, like, without notice, and you can release the buyer, like, without agreement, right? So.
Oh, nice. So yeah, you don't need to sign anything. You're just like, I'll see you later.
Yeah, all they have to do is let you know. And the only thing that you can really pursue on a buyer is if they go buy a house that you showed them and you can prove that, then you can go pursue commission. Oh, mutual release. There you go. But so because of that, I don't have people, and I preface it, I don't have people sign buyer agency. I always tell people when people choose to have me work with them, it's because they're invested in our, like, in, that they trust my guidance. So, and it has sometimes about three times bitten me. But you know what?
I do the same thing. It's, I know that people that have these buyer agreements signed, it deters most people from leaving. But look, if they're going to leave you, let them go. Why do you want that headache, right? So Gene has a question for you. How did you get started and how do they find Vanessa? I don't understand that one. Just tell me how you got started while I figure out the rest of that question.
How I got started in real estate?
Yeah.
Oh man. So I came off deployment. It was the furlough in 2013. I was helping some inbound military people, find houses without, not a realtor, but just like being the person that they would like lean on to go look at stuff. Mm-hmm. And, my mom had been a realtor and I never even thought of that job as a profession. So I was like, you know, I really enjoy like helping people, that the trust that they put on me. And so I went and I got my license. And when the furlough happened, I was able to walk away from my guard job and give my service to the rest of my unit. Cause I was an officer, like, and there was a lot of responsibility on me. So I didn't feel good about leaving, but because thankfully to the furlough, I felt better about, you know, stepping down from full-time service. And so I got into real estate learning from a mortgage broker who was a wholesaler, and he was building his business, was super smart. And I learned all the back end of mortgage, but like how to solve the problems of the VA loan and all the distinguishables between the VA loan guidance and the lender overlays. And then when I learned investments, that's when I started to really build the value that I had to be able to deliver to my clients. So I started lead genning, like in Facebook communities, after I had a knowledge set that I felt like I could give people value.
I love it. So we had a steady 300 people watching this between Facebook and the webinar, which is pretty good.
Yeah.
Tell me anything you want to add that we may have missed, Vanessa?
Yeah. So I'm looking at my notes that I sent you. One second, if there was anything that I wanted to make sure to communicate. I know like the conviction on stuff was a big one the things that I communicate, the stage that I set. Yeah. So Matterport showing assistant. Oh, sometimes you can lean on the listing agent to do video. Although if you write an offer, you need to make sure that you go and someone on your side can do it. The inspector, setting the expectations with the inspector and to emphasize that they are sight unseen, and the cosmetic defects at the closing table. I've done this virtually also, believe it or not, they love it. So if I can't be at the closing table, I send them a video. I will send them a gift basket through the title company. So like it's there at the closing table. And like, I send them this like very like personalized email about like, I'm so excited for you guys. Like, are you ready? Are you scared? Are you nervous? Like, you know, Samantha's amazing. She's my title closer. You know, she's going to take such good care of you. And then they have a surprise at the closing table. And then if I have a very nervous buyer or if I have like a buyer and if I'm kind of duking it out with a listing agent at the end, and there maybe is some things that I need to like be, then I'll jump on Zoom with the title officer and I will be present virtually while they're going through their disclosures. So when I can't be there, I love the video. That's the most leverage. They love it. The closing gift at the title office is something they really enjoy. The title officer will take the photos for me. They really enjoy engaging with you virtually. They feel like they're with you. Also, Zoom chats when parents, sometimes I get a lot of parents and other people that want to be decision makers. I was recently with a builder. I was in a builder showroom and my clients in Oklahoma and their moms in Texas. Okay. And I'm in a builder showroom, like way in the who knows where. And I'm literally picking their finishes for their new construction build in Fairbanks. By the way, I'm in Anchorage. The house is being built in Fairbanks. I will not see it till the blue tape walkthrough. So the house is being built in Fairbanks. I'm in a showroom in Wasilla. I live in Anchorage. The buyer's in Oklahoma and the mom is in Texas. Okay.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Obviously I did all my neighborhood research. I know the Fairbanks market well. I leaned on another realtor there who I trusted for a lot of insight and who I'm giving a smaller referral split. And so basically I was showing them all of the finishes. When you're showing them new construction finishes, you have to be smart with like decor. You have to say this gray has a blue undertone. This floor has a yellow undertone. You have to pick out like really coordinating colors. So your skill set has to be that. Realtors, don't do anything that you're not good at. Refer it to an agent who has that skill set, or hire someone in your business who is good at decorating, you know? So because it'll bite you. So what I'm able to show them in natural light, this looks like this. In the kitchen, it looks dark. This flooring feels thick. This one is darker. Look at these palettes together. I'm putting swatches together. And I can tell them over video or over camera, this doesn't look the same. It looks red in person. It doesn't look red on the screen. Do you see this? And so you bear the weight of being their eyes and ears. And I'll tell you, you have to practice this skill. When I'm deployed in Afghanistan as an intel person, because I probably won't be deployed as an intel person again. But what I'll say is you have to be the eyes and ears for the people that are boots on ground. You know, you have to be able to pull those inherent insights and see through their lens, think the way they would think about them emotionally, mentally, whatever it is that your client is like trying to, you know, do. And you can do a really good job and those people will love you forever.
I love it. Well, on the gift part, that's such a great idea. It reminded me of a company, and I put it on the link there. EvaBot. Have you seen EvaBot?
Oh, I remember that. I'm writing that down right now.
Just reminded me of this because it's EvaBot.ai. And I know they have a special with LCA. I don't know what the hell it is, but just tell them LCA sent you. But right now, it's the perfect time for this. I didn't even realize that until you were talking. I'm like, why didn't I think about this 5 days ago?
We have all this technology at our fingertips. You have to really just learn how to integrate it, how to build your processes around it, how to protect your clients, how to look out for their interests, how to tell, like, be super honest. This is the time that realtors that are willing to say what they need to say and be the most honest are going to build the most amount of trust and are going to be able to come out on the other side.
Oh, that is so, so good. You know who said that to me? It's beautiful that you said that right now. Over the weekend, I was very proactive. Saturday and Sunday, I reached out to 8 different CEOs for all of our major brands for real estate, and also to some great authors and just amazing people. And the CEO of Berkshire Hathaway, his name's Chris Stewart. He said the exact same thing you did. He said, right now is our time to separate ourselves from what the industry has seen over the last few years. Right now is the time to be the professional that we always say we are. And if we can do that right now, we're going to just, you know how we're always we're seen as the used car salesman, the dirty attorney, right?
I hate that. Yeah.
This is the time to separate ourselves from that, right? And you said it beautifully. So thank you, Vanessa. That was awesome. Vanessa, we're going to have an online event. I think it's the first week of April. Can you be on that? Because you had such amazing information.
Absolutely. Happy to contribute whatever people need, you know, want to learn. And what I'll say is sometimes realtors have to lean on being a salesperson because they lack skill. Okay. So when you, if there's no shame in that, like if you're naturally a great salesperson, like, and that's your talent, then just partner with someone who has an incredible amount of skill and learn underneath them. So now your sales, like your salesman skills will also be like partnered with like rock solid analytical, like knowledge. And then you'll be that much more amazing. So, you know, the best thing that you can do for industry is really try to get out of that salesman, like perspective and stigma that so many consumers have of us. And really like partner with someone who has those strengths and use your talents to just be like that much more amazing.
I love it. So thank you. Appreciate it. Let's do this again. You rocked it. Thank you everybody for listening. For those of you that are listening, you're going to get a recording if you signed up on the webinar portion of this. If you're on Facebook, it's pinned to our business page and also playing live right now on Facebook. Thanks, Vanessa.
Bye guys.